Okay, now let's take a look at calculating a correlation coefficient. Suppose we have the following values with scores for 5 people on the variables x and y. And it's a small example because we're going to calculate this by hand, so I want to keep it relatively simple. Here we have, for example, the first person has a score of 1 on x and a score of 6 on y. The second person, 2 on x, 4 on y, and so on. So we have 5 different people here. And the 5 people produced a score on both x and y. So let's go ahead and calculate the correlation, or Pearson's R, on this example. The first thing we want to do, though, is state our null and alternative hypotheses. So the null hypothesis states, this is called rho here, it's the population correlation. So rho xy equals 0. Or, in other words, the correlation between x and y in the population equals 0. And that means that there is no relationship between x and y in the population. And once again, this means rho. Then the alternative hypothesis is really just the opposite of that. Notice everything's the same except equals for null, not equals for alternative. So the alternative hypothesis is that the population correlation between x and y is not equal to 0, as you can see here. And this is really saying that there is a relationship between x and y in the population. It could be a positive relationship or a negative relationship. Or in other words, we're conducting a two-tailed test here. In terms of the calculations, first we'll begin with calculating the mean of x and the mean of y. So to find the mean of x and y, starting with x, we're just going to add all of these values together, and we're going to divide by the number of values that there are. So 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5 divided by 5 total gives us a mean of 3 for x. And then we'll do the same for y. So we add all these values and divide by 5, and that gives us a mean of 4. Okay, next we need to calculate what are known as deviation scores for each variable. Deviation scores subtract the mean from each variable. They're called deviation scores because they indicate how far each value deviates or departs from the mean. So let's take a look at that now. You know, there's a lot of information here on the screen, but let me walk you through it. It's really not that bad. Recall that the mean of x was 3 and the mean of y was 4. So here are my x values. And all I'm doing here, notice the 3 for the mean, is taking the x value and subtracting the mean from it, as I had mentioned a few moments ago. So here we're just going to go 1 minus 3. So you see that here. 1 minus 3 is equal to negative 2. Then we take 2 minus 3, our mean again, equal to negative 1. 3 minus 3, 0. 4 minus the mean of 3 gives us 1. And 5 minus the mean of 3 gives us 2. An interesting thing here, if your calculations are correct, these deviation scores should all add up to 0. So notice here we have negative 2, negative 1, that's negative 3. 0, we can ignore that. Then we have positive 3. So negative 3 plus positive 3 is 0. Notice how these all add up to 0. And that's by definition, because the mean of 3 here is a balance point in the distribution. And it always balances out the deviation scores below the mean with the deviation scores above the mean. So this should equal 0 when you add these up. If it does not, that means that an error was made in the calculations. Okay, so now let's find the deviation scores for y. So once again, we just take the value for y and subtract the mean, which is 4 in this case, from each value. So 6 minus 4 is 2, 4 minus 4 is 0, 5 minus 4 is 1, 3 minus 4 is negative 1, and 2 minus 4 is negative 2. Now let's take a look at this. We have positive 3, negative 3, notice how those add up to 0 again, so that looks good. Okay, so that's it for the deviation scores. So next what we need to do is we need to square each of these values. We need to square the deviation scores. And the reason for that is it gets rid of the negative numbers. Remember how when I showed you that the deviation scores always sum or add up to 0? We can't really do much with it if our answer is 0. So when we square them, that gets rid of the negative values. And then later we'll take care of that square by taking the square root at the end. I'll show you that later. But for now, step three is squaring the deviation scores. So these were our deviation scores from earlier that we calculated. So all we're doing now for x is squaring each one, and that gives us these values. And for y, we're squaring each of those deviation scores, and we get these values here. Okay, so that's done. We've squared all those. Now all we want to do is add up those squared values. Now, technically speaking, we do call this the sum of the squared deviation scores. And you may see this in your text or in other places, usually shorthanded as SS, or sum of the squares, it's called, as shorthand. Okay, so sum of the squares, or SS, is equal to adding up all of the squared deviation scores. So that's what we'll do here. So we have our squared deviation scores here for X and for Y. So all we do now is just add those up, and SS, or sum of the squares for X, when we add these values together, gives us 10. And SS for Y also gives us 10. Now, it's not always the case when you calculate a correlation that SSX and SSY will be equal to each other. That just happened to occur in this example. So don't expect that you have to see these as equal. They absolutely do not have to be equal whatsoever. But they are on occasion. Okay, so finally what we need to do is find what are called the cross products. Now, cross products just multiply that word product, right? Multiply the two deviation scores together. So let's take a look at this next. Now, when you first see this, it may look a little intimidating, but let me walk you through it. It's really not that bad because we've done most of this already. Recall we found the deviation score for X, right? These values here. And we found the deviation scores for Y. We've already done that. Now, all we do to find the sum of the products is we multiply the deviation score for X by the deviation score for Y for a given person. So here we have negative 2 times positive 2. You see that here? This product is negative 4. Multiplying the deviation scores for the second person, negative 1 times 0. We see that here? That's 0. Third person, 0 times 1 is 0. The fourth person, 1 times negative 1 is negative 1. And then finally, for the last person, 2 times negative 2 is negative 4. Now, those are the cross products, and what we have to do is find the sum of them, so we have to add them up. Okay, and that's what we do right here. We have negative 4, 0, 0, negative 1, negative 4. So that's what you see here, all added together, and that gives us a sum of the products of negative 9. Okay, a very quick review. We found the mean. Then we found the deviation scores, these here, and then we squared them, added them together, and then our last step here, we found the cross products, and then we sum those up. So we found the sum of the products, or SP. So we have everything we need to calculate our correlation. So here's our formula for the correlation coefficient, or Pearson's R. Sum of the products divided by square root of SSX times square root of SSY. And we found all of these values, so we're ready to go. Recall that SSX and Y were both 10 in this example, and the SP was negative 9. So we'll just go ahead and plug these values in. We have negative 9 over square root of 10 times square root of 10. And that gives us, when we work it out, an R of negative 0.9. Okay, so once again, our value of Pearson's R is negative 0.9. We can stop right here and just report that our R was negative 0.9 and we can be done. However, if we want to know whether this value is statistically significant, that is, whether it's significantly different from zero, then we need to conduct a hypothesis test. We'll do that next.